Decode Your Fatigue, a clinically proven 12-step plan to increase your energy, heal your body, and transform your life. Written and read by Alex Howard. Part 1. What is fatigue? Chapter 1. Radical Responsibility. Like most people, I grew up believing that if you fall ill, you take a pill, and you feel better. At least that was until just before my 16th birthday, when I found myself in a physical hell that no pill could cure. I woke up one morning and something felt very wrong. It was as though someone had pulled the plug on the energy in my body, and I had none left. The short walk from my bedroom to the bathroom felt like a marathon. My muscles ached, and I became lightheaded while doing even the most basic tasks. Following several visits to the doctor and various blood tests, it was concluded that I had a virus. I just needed to rest, I was told, and all would be back to normal in a month or two. That felt like a lifetime for a teenage boy who just wanted to play sport and make music with his friends. For a while, ignorance wasn't exactly bliss, but it never crossed my mind that what I was experiencing was anything more sinister than a virus that would pass in its own time. Except it didn't. 3 months later, and I was heading to the doctor once more in search of answers. This time, my grandmother was leading the charge. If anyone could get answers, it was her. My health hadn't improved since my last appointment. In fact, it had declined significantly. An attempt to restart school a few weeks earlier had gone horribly wrong. After 10 days of pushing through and pretending there was nothing wrong with me, I'd crashed and was now feeling worse than ever. The doctor's surgery office was only a 5-minute drive from our home, but it might as well have been a million miles away. By the time we arrived, I was so dizzy I could hardly stand, and the exhaustion was so crippling it took everything I had to not just lie on the floor and curl up in a ball. As we sat in the waiting room, I tried to distract myself by scanning the other patients. With a strange kind of envy, I found myself wishing I could swap my illness for a more tangible condition. I'd willingly have taken a broken limb or some kind of unpleasant infectious disease because they at least have a clear recovery path. The lack of clarity on my own way forward was almost as bad as my crippling symptoms. When I was called in to see the doctor, my grandmother accompanied me. As I completed my description of the latest developments, or lack thereof, she interrupted. "Do you think it could be chronic fatigue syndrome, or ME?" she asked the doctor, in the slightly overassertive voice someone uses when they realize that they might be speaking out of turn. A long pause followed, during which the doctor's face assumed a somewhat pensive expression. My slower-than-normal brain used this interval to try and make sense of what my grandmother had just suggested. I didn't know much about chronic fatigue syndrome, but I understood it was bad news, and that it was a diagnosis I didn't want. Eventually, the doctor responded, "Yes, I think that's the most likely explanation." After another pause, I stepped in. "Well, what does that mean?" I asked. "Is there a pill I can take or something?" "No, I'm afraid there is nothing I can give you," he replied. "The best I can offer is counseling." As I struggled to process the enormity of what the doctor was telling me, that I had a serious condition for which nothing could be done, the suggestion that I have counseling stung deeply. I wanted to shout and scream about how ridiculous it was, but I didn't have the energy. How could he be so insulting? My illness was in my body, not my mind. The downside of hope. It would take several years before the horror of that autumn morning fully sank in. As the months passed, my grandmother, unwilling to accept that conventional medicine couldn't provide a solution to my condition, dragged me around the weird and wonderful local alternative healthcare scene. Nutritionists, energy healers, Chinese and Indian medicine practitioners, I saw them all. I remember feeling genuinely hopeful and excited on the first few occasions. However, a clear and predictable pattern soon emerged. The virtues of the latest offering would be described to me, and I'd read a leaflet that included testimonials from people with symptoms like my own. I'd suspend my disbelief and become optimistic that the treatment would work, only to be disappointed once more, when a few weeks or months later, it became clear that it wasn't making a blind bit of difference. In time, I stopped getting my hopes up. Not because I didn't want to get better. I did. I wanted it more than anything. But because I could no longer handle the emotional roller coaster of disappointment. I wasn't cynical by nature, but I became cynical because it was the only way I could protect myself from the downside of hope. Over the next 2 years, I saw numerous supposed medical experts. I radically transformed my diet. I had more blood tests than I was aware existed. And I consulted everyone from faith healers to people I'm not sure were medically sane, all to no avail. If anything, my symptoms got worse. And after a prolonged period in this living hell, my mindset certainly did. The turning point. My health reached its lowest ebb when I was 18. And while it wouldn't be true to say I was suicidal because I didn't want to die, at the same time, I just couldn't see a way to keep living in the nightmare my life had become. I was in pain every day, sometimes taking the few steps from my bedroom to the bathroom felt like climbing Mount Everest. It was in this state of desperation that I picked up the phone one day and called my uncle and had the conversation that would change the course of my life. My uncle was a bit like Gandalf in Lord of the Rings. He wasn't around very often, but he did have a sneaky habit of turning up at just the right time with just the right words of advice before disappearing again over the horizon. I'd learned to deeply admire and respect him from a distance, and the fact that he ran an indie record label also made him very cool to an aspiring punk rock guitarist like myself. When you have a severe chronic illness, it's not so easy to rely on the usual pleasantries when beginning a conversation. The seemingly innocuous question, "How are you?" has multifaceted answers, and "I'm fine, thank you," as polite and normal as it sounds, is a blatant lie. Fine falls into the same category as pleasant or amiable. It can refer more to the absence of something than to its presence. However, by that stage in my illness, I was past the point of caring what other people thought of me. Without the energy left to hold back, I told my uncle exactly how I felt. I hated my life and everything in it. I didn't want to face another day of the hell my life had become. I was at the end of my tether, and I couldn't take much more. Now, one would typically expect a response of compassion and gentleness in such a situation. And it wasn't that my uncle didn't know that I deserved both, he did. But he also realized that tea and biscuit sympathy wasn't going to change anything. He knew that, as hard as it might seem, if I wanted the circumstances of my life to change, I was going to have to change them myself. He started off by asking me a simple question. On a scale of 0 to 10, how badly do you want to get better? I didn't have to think about it for long. I believed I'd do virtually anything, short of murder or amputating one of my limbs, to get better. I decided I was a 9.5 out of 10. My next task was to make a list of all the things I thought I could do to get better, followed by a list of all the things that made me worse. My uncle suggested I put down the phone and come up with these two lists before calling him back in 10 minutes. As I compiled my list of the things I could do to get better, I uncovered all kinds of excuses. I'd already tried everything and nothing had worked. And how was I supposed to find answers when no one else had? However, I respected my uncle and I was also desperate. So I listed things like meditation and yoga and learning more about food and nutrition. I even wrote exploring more about psychology. I was that desperate. I then worked on my list of things that made me worse. I had just one word: life. It felt as if trying to get...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.